A few weeks ago, I made a video called What They Don't Say About the Scottish Accent. And in the comments section, somebody asked how I could speak for 15 minutes about Scots accents and yet leave a key thing out. So, was Abraham Tomahawk being frivolous or serious? Was Abraham Tomahawk really the name that his parents gave him? More importantly, was he right about how critical his suggestion was to my conversation about the Scots language? Whether you're an international that watches to learn about Scotland or a Scot that watches to reminisce, this video is for you. Because today, I'm going to talk about the Broons and Oor Wullie. If you're interested in the people, places and events in Scottish history, then click the subscribe button at the bottom right of the screen. In the meantime, switch on the subtitles and let me tell you a story. So, in the comment section, Abraham Tomahawk said, 15 minutes about Scots and no mention of the Broons or Oor Wullie. Bowfin. That's a Scottish word. In fact, apparently, Mr. Tomahawk's second favourite after Tumshie. Not only am I going to justify why there was no mention of the Broons or Oor Wullie, I'm also going to give you a wee bit of history, a trip down the memory vennel, some cultural observations from the Broons and Oor Wullie, and some questions for you to answer in the comment section, one of which will be a competition with a prize. If you're an international viewer, you're going to get a feel for one of the cornerstones of Scottish culture growing up. And this is the first time I've said this, but you'll probably get as much information about Scottish culture from reading the comment section as you do from the video. I know that I'm going to be interested to see the answers. So, first question, Scottish people. Did you or did you not get a Broons book or an Oor Wullie annual every year for Christmas? Even as an adult, I used to give my elder sister a Broons book for Christmas, which must have pissed her off when she was hoping for a £20 note and a box of Victoria biscuits. Now, here's one of my younger sisters. She's now a seamstress in Perth. In fact, she made this shirt. We've got the same dad, but a different mum. And some people say to me, Bruce, did your dad like to sow his wild oats? And let me tell you, he was a very enthusiastic farmer. This is my younger sister's laddie. Now, he's a big, strapping, handsome, rapalicious hunk of a man today. But when he was a wee laddie growing up in Accra, Ghana, you can imagine how he might have looked forward with eager anticipation to see what his uncle in the rich, developed West would send them for his Christmas. Will it be money? Will it be cool Western clothing? Will it be the latest technological gadget? No, it's a Broons book. And next year, it'll be an Oor Wullie annual. Imagine him opening that international parcel and thinking, jings, cribbins, help my bob. You just know he's going to get bullied at school. Now, just in case you're one of my international viewers who didn't have a kindly Afro-Celtic uncle, let me introduce you to the Broons. They're a typical Scottish family. There's Ma Broon, there's Pa Broon, there's two adult sons, Hen and Joe, two adult daughters, Maggie and Daphne, a teenager, Horace, Gallet for George, a pair of, I'd say, eight-year-old twin boys. Actually, I don't ken their names. Does anybody ken? Let me know in the comment section, right? And finally, of course, you've got the bairn. I have no idea how old she is. Somewhere at 4 and 36, I'd say. So, a widespread of ages that suggest Ma and Pa Broon have been having a rumpy bumpy long after either of them look fit for the rumping or the pumping. Eight children, fae adult to toddler, and none of them look like the fae that. Your typical Scottish family. All I'm saying, my Canadian cousin, is when your DNA test tells you they're 46% Scottish, then you assume there's going to be corresponding birth certificates. There was a war on, you can. Anyway, there's Grandpa Broon and all, but he bides in his own house in a different street, where he keeps dues in his garden. Now, I ken this because Oor Wullie, a wee rascal, a primary school laddie, probably about ages with the twins, gets a whole comic book to himself. And each episode, I ends up with him sitting in his garden on an upturned bucket. So he gangs round to Grandpa Broon's day, and the two of them hear a race. They went fleeing down the street, Willie and Grandpa Broon's bike, and Grandpa Broon in Willie's bogey. Now, Grandpa Broon promised if Willie won, he'd give him in his prize homing pigeons. As it was, Willie did win the race, and he took the doo home. But surprise, surprise, by the next morning, it was back at Grandpa's house. It was a homing pigeon, ya roaster! How we laughed. Each Broons and Oor Wullie cartoon strip involved some daft misunderstanding like that, where somebody ended up with egg in their pus. And it was written in a broadly universal broad Scots. Now, recently, one of my neighbours, Kenny Hutton, told me that he'd bought some Broons and Oor Wullie books in a charity shop with cartoon strips going all the way back to when they started on the 8th of March 1936. Now, for the sake of the internationals, they appeared in a Dundee-based paper that sells all Scotland, cried the Sunday Post. It only comes out one day a week, but I didn't care what day that is. It doesn't matter. There's another question, actually. How far away from Dundee do they sell the Sunday Post? Anyway, at the end of the year, they put together the best of the strips into a book. One year, it'll be a set of Broon strips, the next, Oor Wullie. Until they started milking it by selling the away strips and all. Anyway, that's how I mind it. If I'm picking berries up the wrong trail, then I'm sure you'll let me ken in the comment section. The very first Broons characters were a wee bit different for the days, but they were still recognisable. The flapper girl, Maggie, the dark moustached Paw, Hen the Spiv, and Daphne the Tramp. I think she used my hairdresser. Oor Wullie looked a wee bit different and all. Now, Grandpa Broon didn't come in until November 1936. For the first 8 months, nobody thought he was dead. But he turned up safe and sound. He must have been a homing grandpa. When I started reading through these strips for the 1930s, the first thing that I noticed was the gratuitous carnage and violence. Right? In the first four strips, we've got Oor Wullie causing injury to the public by deliberately ramming a steamroller into a tram. That's right, people of Edinburgh, trams. It was the 1930s. Then you've got the Broon twins damaging property and injuring a photographer before their maw battered them. Grandpa Broon and Willie racing dudes, that's not so bad. And then one where Paw Broon ends up attacking the staff and casualty. Pretty much every episode involves something getting nicked, something getting broken, or somebody getting battered. And all of these smoking fags are a pipe, even the bairn. I'm joking. That was a joint. During the Empire Exhibition in 1938, the Broons headed off to Bellahouston Park, where Paw and Grandpa Broon were chased by an escaped lion that they didn't think was there. They escaped by rowing across a loch that actually wasn't there. What a commotion. Oor Wullie went to the same exhibition and he had to write an essay for the teacher describing waterfalls, the Canadian Mounties, and the beaver that he saw. But he wasn't allowed to use slang words in the essay, so stop it. Between the 29th of October 1939 and the 10th of March 1946, Hen and Joe were aye drawn in uniform because it was the war. For the 7th of February 1943, you didn't see them at all because as adult males, they were away on active duty. But they survived the war and they came back. Now, the message for these comic strips aren't they radical. They're twee, establishment, small c conservative Scotland. So what about Abe the Hatchet whining about me no mentioning the Broons? In that video, what they don't say about the Scottish accent, for which I'll leave a link at the end, by the way, I blathered on about how when we were bairns, Voices of Authority would scold us for speaking Scots. Apart from once a year at burn season. But in truth, we were allowed the Broons and Oor Wullie on a Sunday and all. Oh, and you might get away with a wee bit of Scots at Christmas, when the annual came out. If you were any of those unfortunate bairns in Africa, it might even get rammed down your thrapple by your uncle. So why were these comic strips okay? Why were they mainstream and accepted by the small C, maybe even big C, conservative establishment? The first thing that I'd say is that as I read through this book, I noticed that the Broons and Oor Wullie actually use a combination of Scots and standard English. A bit like myself. It's like when you get a chicken pakora, but know the full boona. Is the full boona a Scottish expression? Do you use that other place? Let me, Ken, do other folk use that expression? Here's another thought. These are comic strips. They're a wee bit Harry Lauder music hall. They're not to be taken seriously. Many times have you actually said, Jings, Crivens, help my bob. It's like the lovely English lassie who commented in that video about the Scottish accents, and she said, do you actually ever hear people say, bra, bricked, moonlicked, nicked, the nicked? And I said, oh aye, I hear English folks say it all the time. And sadly, way too many Scottish bairns these days and all. So, whilst the Broons and Oor Wullie were a staple at every household, whilst they were one of the few release valves for us to be allowed to see a family speak with our voice, it was acceptable because it was comic, exaggerated. They're no real. That's why I'm not sure they really fitted into a video about the actual history of the Scots language. But here's something it did. Billy Kay's book, The Mither Tongue, it's a great explanation of the history and vibrancy of the Scots language. I sat down with Billy and filmed a long conversation with him that's going to be on the Patreon members page. Now, if you want to become a Patreon member, then just click the tab up there. But even if you didn't, it's now come out as an audiobook with Billy himself reading it. So if you're Scottish or international and you want to hear the story of Scots in English, there's no need for subtitles, that you hear it spoken with a Scots accent about the Scots language read by that very Scot himself. It's available on Audible. Now, Billy's given me a code for a free download for the Audible book for the winner of our competition. Now, I'm going to give you a question. The best answer to the question in the comments by the 12th of February will win that free Audible version of The Mother Tongue. Now, if you didn't win the competition, you can still listen to it potentially free because Audible do a free 30-day trial. I'm going to leave a link to the audiobook in the description below. You can click that link, sign up for a 30-day trial and listen to the book. Now, if you like the idea of audiobooks and you want to continue after the 30 days, then it's £7.99 a month. As of February 2022, they give you a credit a month for an audiobook of your choice. I use it all the time. Now, the most recent book that I downloaded was Sunset Song by Lewis Grassic Gibbon, but I've done all the Rebus books as well. Booze, fags, murders. You're going to get more Scottish than that. So, here's the question. When I was a teacher at Brechin High School, I remember a debate in the staff room about where the Broons lived. Some said it was Glasgow, and others said it must be Dundee. Because, as I said, the publisher, DC Thompson, was a Dundee company. Now, there's a 50-50 chance that even if you just guessed that, you'd get it right. But the winner wouldn't be the answer Glasgow or Dundee. In fact, even if you get that bit of the answer wrong, you can still win because the winner will be what my wife, Mrs. Colombo, deems the most interesting, entertaining or informative reason as to why it's Glasgow or Dundee. Now, I'm not going to get involved. I'll be honest with you. I've lived with her for 32 years and I've got no way of predicting what she's going to like. But part of that debate in the staff room was, where's the button, Ben? You see, as well as having boxing matches in the living room, nicking each other's stuff, forcing suit down their neighbour's lum, and leaving 8-year-old twins to babysit for a 4-year-old bairn, and we all ended up with shaved heads, this ordinary Glaswegian slash Dundonian family had a button Ben holiday home in the countryside, just like every Ouijian Kogi the day. The staff room debate raged as to whether the button Ben was in the Angus hillside or the Campsie hills. So, you see, the winner will be the explanation of why you think they came for which tune, even if they didn't. If YouTube's listening, this would be a good place to put an advert before I tell the folks a Broons story. Are you sitting comfortably? You, let me get started. Well, a Broons story for Sunday Post on the 8th of July, 1951. We start with a Hale family in a train carriage. Now, I say the Hale family. In fact, I can't see Daphne or any of the twins in this. Has there been two murders? They're heading down to the Firth of Forth for a wee holiday in Auntie Jeannie's cottage when she's away for the weekend. Grandpa Broons got a big soft bundle. Whoever misses. And he says that's his gear for going fishing. Strange. It doesn't look like fishing rods. Anyway, they get to the cottage and judging by the position of the Forth Bridge, it must be in North Queensferry. Come along, the fifers. Oh, and thank goodness Daphne's turned up. But any of the twins are still missing. Hen and Joe help Grandpa load the boat with his soft bundle and twa lang poles, as Ma, Pa, Yin Twin and the bairn look on. When they're out in the Firth of Forth, it turns out that the bundle is sheets and they stretch them out with poles. As time passes, the family watch for the shore, awfully curious-like. Eventually, it gets a bit cold and they decide to haul in the sheets and head back. Now back at the shore, Pa slags off Grandpa because he couldn't have caught a bite with on sheets. And Joe points out he wasn't even trying to catch fish. The sheets were to catch coins that folk threw off the train for good luck as it crossed the Forth Bridge. Grandpa's haul for the day was £1.12 and threepence. In the 50s! I'll be honest, I've been across that bridge and I didn't remember doing that. Let me know in the comments section if you ever did that. On the 20th of August 1969, Dudley Watkins, the artist that drew the characters, died. DC Thompson kept up output by reusing old strips and various different artists short term before settling on the illustrator Ken Harrison. Oor Wullie and the Broons are undoubtedly iconic parts of Scottish culture, but they're made uppy. If you want the real life history of the Scots language, then why not watch this video here? Hamiadoch is going to be a lamb alive. Cheery and drastic.